everyone, this is Ishtar with another episode of the Naked Shaman. Today I want to talk to you about Halloween, because we're coming up to Halloween in a few days' time, and I thought people would be interested anyway in knowing about the magical underpinnings of Halloween and what actually the festival is really all about. Because we get a hint that it's something to do with magic, in that the children dress up in witches' costumes and ghosts sheets and strange fairy costumes and go door to door asking for sweets, basically. And that's really all that Halloween means to us now. But it does actually come from a much, much deeper tradition that was practiced all over the world at one time before Christianity. And this deeper tradition is connected in with magic. And magic is all about timing. And this time is very, very special. I would say starting from today, which is the Taurus full moon, otherwise known as the Hunter's moon, because it's when Orion first appears in our skies after being absent for the whole of the summer. The Hunter's moon, I would say going right up to 11th, 12th of November, which is celebrated by Remembrance Sunday now, the Red Poppy Day, and includes Bonfire Night, which even before Guy Fawkes was a particular festival where they burned the bones, because they would have killed the carcasses of the animals and salted them for winter, and then they would throw all the bones on a fire. And this was the bone fire, the bonfire, and it's actually Bonfire Night. It may well be that Guy Fawkes was going to blow up the Houses of Parliament on that day, and maybe he was going to do it because he understood some of the magical underpinnings of this very special time. But it was a festival before that. I'm very anxious to get us in touch with our root traditions, and in this country it's the Celtic tradition, which has been suborned and, I would say, to some degree completely repressed and suppressed in order for the sovereignty to be given to a whole other load of people. I say this so often, but I'll say it again. It's really important to get back in touch with our own traditions, because otherwise we will be like so much chaff just blown across the earth with the talk these days about no borders, no territory, no roots. And then we'll be so much more easily manipulated by the powers that be. And so the magic that I talk about is earth magic, and it's the magic that comes from the land but resonates with the stars. And this festival of Halloween used to be called All Hallows Eve. And so why is it called Hallows? What does Hallows mean? Well, the hallows in Celtic mythology were the accoutrements of sovereignty. And these accoutrements of sovereignty had to be won by the hero, the zodiac hero, if you like, as he travels around the zodiac. He's born on the winter solstice as the radiant child. He starts to come into his manhood around about the time of Aries in March, which is governed by Mars, and he becomes a Martian warrior. By Martian, I don't mean the planet, I mean with influence by those planetary influences astrologically. And then he comes to Taurus, where he meets for the first time a woman, Venus, who governs Taurus. But he's too young and immature to really appreciate her. He's at the stage of his life when he's sort of on a permanent all-boys night out, you know, so he really isn't interested in true love at this stage, which is normal. And so then he carries on around the zodiac, meeting various sort of animals or spirits that he has interactions with, and from each one, even if it's antagonistic, he learns from them. And then he gets to Leo, which is the house of the king, the sun king, the palace, if you like. And he then stays in the palace of the sun king for a while until he travels on then past Virgo, then he meets again at Libra, the beautiful woman, and by now he's mature enough and wise enough to fall in love with her. And he stays with her for a while, but he can't stay with her forever because his next challenge comes in Scorpio, and that's when he has to meet the Deathly Hallows. And this is facing death. And some of you who are Harry Potter fans will know that that was the last book in the Harry Potter series, where Harry has to face death, his own death, in order to win the Deathly Hallows, the accoutrements of kingship. In his case, the accoutrements of magicianship. So it was initiation for Harry Potter. And he does that, and it's quite interesting. I think J.K. Rowling really knew quite a lot about these mystery traditions, in the way that she's done the whole series of those books. Everything in them is very deep magic in those books. So what does it mean to face death at this time? Is it a literal death? Well, no. But there is a lot of about death around at this time, which is to do with going, retreating. It's the sort of death that we see around us in nature. If you look at the trees, the leaves are turning brown and red and gold and then falling off and falling down onto the forest floor, where they eventually die completely. But they don't die absolutely, because they transform and they turn into most beautiful, rich leaf mould, which, if you can get some and put it on your garden, is the very best fertiliser that you can get. And so these cycles go round and round. It's not a linear path with a brick wall at the end of it. Time is circular. Time is cyclical. We're on a wheel. And so we're just going down on the wheel at this time. And for me, this is one of the most magical times of the year. These few weeks coming up to the middle of November. Some of the work, the shamanic work or magical work that I've done at this time, has been so powerful that it's still reverberating today, years later. And the work we do at this time is often to do with ancestors and to do with family. This was also the time that was signified by the setting of the Pleiades star constellation. It doesn't set now at this time because we have a different view of the night skies because of the precession of the equinoxes, and so it's changing all the time. But that just shows you how old this festival is, and to the Celts it was called Samhain. It's spelt with an M, but it sounds like a sow, like a female pig. Samhain, Samhain. And this Samhain is an extraordinary time because it is a time for getting in touch with the ancestors and remembering our dead. There's a very powerful, and you know, you don't have to be a shaman to do this, by the way. I mean, it will still work if you do it with integrity and sincerity. But at this time, I always do a ceremony for the dead, where I remember all the dead in my family and say their names, and I light a candle for them, and I say their names, and I give thanks for their lives on this earth. And I ask for the support of the ancestors now to help me in my work. And this can be done very simply, with just a very simple, you can make a little altar, light a candle, light a few candles, and say the names of the most, perhaps recently departed, in your lifetime, let's say. And you'll find that this has a very, very powerful resonance in your life for a long time afterwards. This was always performed, this ceremony, as I said, for thousands of years and going back thousands of years. It's only recently been, let's say, hijacked by Remembrance Sunday. And Remembrance Sunday is really just about remembering the war dead, not all the dead. And in fact, it's about remembering specific war dead, those that died in the Bankers' Wars, the Rothschilds' Wars, the Morgans' Wars. These are the Bankers' Wars, they're not real wars. And we remember those dead that died in those wars, but what about everybody else? Do they not have any value was their life of no value because they didn't die for the bankers. That may seem a little harsh, but that's the way I see it. This is not to disrespect soldiers that go to war to fight for their country. My father fought for his country, and I'm sure you all know, you all have relatives who fought for their country too, and we honour that. But unfortunately, in my opinion, many of those that were fighting for their country, who believe they were, including my father, were actually fighting for the bankers. That these wars were not real wars, they were phony wars, just like the wars today. And so while we honour them, those soldiers, we don't have to honour the war. And unfortunately, Remembrance Sunday has become about honouring war. It's about celebrating war as we watch all these old soldiers in Whitehall march past the cenotaph with all the red poppies. The red poppy, by the way, is an astral symbol. So at this time, it's almost, you know, particularly on the television, on the BBC, if you're on the BBC at this time, in any capacity, even on children's television, you have to wear a red poppy. And it's like saying, yes, I'm part of that club. I'm not part of that club. I won't be wearing a red poppy. And I also have seen it on the astral planes. I asked to be shown the astral underpinnings of what creates this force in people, what makes people obedient to this force every year that comes along and tells them to wear a red poppy and puts, you know, asks them to take part in this celebration of war. No matter how much they spin it, it is a celebration of war, and it has a very strong effect on our young people when they see those old and blind and injured soldiers going past the cenotaph, which is this huge phallic symbol, to be honest. They are affected, and it gives them a feeling about war being a glorious activity, that they start to feel that they cannot become men unless they take part in these wars. And that's how they recruit more soldiers generation after generation. They just recruit them for these bankers' wars. So I would like us to get in touch with the real meaning of All Hallows Eve, Halloween, Samhain. Another way you can do this is to have a fire and to throw anything on the fire that is no longer serving your highest interest. I've talked about this a little bit before, but in a way, the spirits of the earth are necromantic, and that means they take our waste. What to us is waste, if given in love as an offering, becomes food for them, and they really do appreciate this food. And that's another reason for having the bonfire, the burning of the bones, is that, you know, you're giving back to the earth. You're becoming a part of the cycle of the earth in that way. So there's just such an enormously rich potential at this time during the next few weeks, and I hope you really do make the most of it. I want also to talk about the death side of it in terms of how do we get in touch with that? Okay, we can see it around us in nature, but what does it mean for us? In terms of this magical work. And it is about an underworld journey, in fact. It's about going down into the underworld. And this is talked about a lot in the Welsh and Irish ballads, where they had heroes who would go down into the underworld, otherwise known as the world of the Fae, if you like, or fairyland. The Fae are just the spirits of the earth. And so how does one undertake this underworld journey? Well, we go into trance. And we go into trance, and through that we become changed. Because we become changed because we spend time with these other beings that are not in this world. And so we do die to this world, but we come back. It's not a permanent death. Just like the leaf mold feeds back into the earth, we feed back in to our true selves and come back better, transformed, purified, with deeper wisdom. And this is what we do as shamans when we go into trance. That's one of the journeys that we can do. There's a very good book about this. I'm going to give you a quote now from R.J. Stewart. R.J. Stewart's a beautiful writer, and he lives in Glastonbury. And he's written a book about this underworld journey. And I think you might find it interesting to hear what he has to say about this underworld journey that's undertaken at this time. An individual who emerges from the underworld may or may not have unusual powers of consciousness or energy, but these are interim patterns, side effects of transformation. The greatest magical gift in the Western tradition is not power, but the tongue that cannot lie. Beyond this stage, further development is of a spiritual order, and the magical initiations are superseded. So that's an extract from the Underworld Initiation by R.J. Stewart. And if you'd like to know more about what I'm talking about, I would recommend that book, and I'll put a link to some more information that you can get about that. But the boon of the Fairy Queen, as it's known, is the tongue that cannot lie. And this is a bit of a double-edged sword, I can tell you from personal experience. It's become almost impossible for me to lie. And there are times when it would be so much simpler if I could, and save a lot of trouble. But on the other hand, it is an extraordinary gift, because it's more than about having a tongue that cannot lie. It enables you to see through to the truth in many, many situations which before were clouded to you. So it is like a sword in that way, that it cuts through. It cuts through all the bullshit on so many different levels, that it is the pearl beyond price. And I'm really very grateful to have that. Some more, just a couple more quotes from R.J. Stewart, because his work is just, again, that his work is the pearl beyond price. There is no writer like him out there. So he says, a religion always commences with individual absorption into the group entity. The mysteries always commence with the individual separation from that entity. Both ways reach the same goal if they are effective. But the underworld is a shortened way in which major alterations of consciousness are gained within one lifetime or a period of 7 years. Loss of individuality plays no part in the tradition, but individuality should not be confused with personality. During the journey, the personality is lost, shattered, disintegrated. The individuality remains, emerges from fire in its true nature. Our personalities are mainly an expression of reaction to the group world. The individuality is a direct reflection of the creative archetype that resonates at the core of human life and being. So I think he also gives us a clue there as to the difficulties that can come up during this time. He talks about the personality is shattered, disintegrated, lost. And it's a little bit like what we were talking about last week with Satan, how the Satan angel, Saturn, is a very Saturnic path right now, because you are being sort of, I don't know, everything that used to work before may not be working anymore. That's usually how it happens for me. So things that you rely on and you're just going along on automatic. And if you're not really paying attention to this turn in the wheel, this downturn in the wheel, you're still acting as if you're on top of the wheel and the wheel still hasn't turned, you can fall off, basically. And it takes the form of, it can take the form of illness, and it can take the form of really bad luck, as they call it, in your life. But it isn't really bad luck, it's just nature's way. We could even say the Pleiades way of making you turn inwards. That the Pleiades are so connected with this time, I think, is no coincidence, because they're often also associated with misfortune, illness, and accidents happening to you. it isn't that it's the devil playing with you, or that you've come under an evil spell or an evil star. It literally is that you need to stop. You need to stop and turn energies, your energies, inwards, because this is an inward journey now, and it will be for the next few weeks at least, until we start coming into the time of Capricorn again. So we're probably, from my experience, it goes through most of Sagittarius until we get to the winter solstice in various forms. And then when we get to the winter solstice, the hero is reborn as the radiant child. So this is a really wonderful time. It's a very rich time, very powerful time. I wanted to tell you about it so that you can take the best advantage of it, and wish you a joyful and rich Samhain. Thank you for listening. If you'd like to hear more of these broadcasts, please subscribe or click the like button at least, because then that tells YouTube to make the video available to more people. Thanks for listening. Bye.